Hello everybody and welcome back to the Game of Thrones AI Deathmatch series. This is part 6, and we are going to continue our journey from the last episode. And speaking of the last episode, I do apologize, as I find myself apologizing very often, I find, that my episode was incredibly, incredibly short. In fact, this is because we did have company coming over, so I apologize that I had to cut the episode short. This episode, in contrast, will be a normal length episode. So get ready, sit down, grab a beer or grab a coffee, whatever you guys need to grab, grab a snack, and prepare yourself for this latest episode of the Game of Thrones Deathmatch series. So the last episode, again, it was kind of short, but for those of you guys who did miss it, we're seeing a lot of war going on here in the southern eastern part of Westeros, mainly between Dorne and the Stormlands, led by both Renly Baratheon and Doran of Dorne. Doran of Dorne, yeah, that's a bit hard to say. Also, I've noticed a lot of you guys in the comment section have been saying that I made a bit of an error when I called Eddard Stark Neddard, and I do apologize. It must have been because frequently in the TV show, at least not in the book, they do refer to Eddard as Ned, and because his name is Eddard and they call him Ned, I just, you know, put one and two together and called him Neddard. So again, for those of you guys who are like offended that I was, you know, committing this sacrilege against your one of your favorite characters, well, you know, again, what can I do about it? You know, I do make mistakes from time to time. So with that being taken out of, I guess, consideration or whatever, we're going to go ahead and begin where we left off. Now, of course, Renly Baratheon is currently at war with Dorne, so we're going to be kind of showcasing the southern eastern part of Westeros. But in addition to that, we also have some warfare going up on here in the north, of course, between Robb Stark, the King of the North and the King of Winterfell, and the Greyjoys, led by, God, what's this guy's name? Lord Balon Greyjoy of the Iron Islands. I do have to check sometime their names because it's been so long since I've read the books and seen the TV show. So again, they are currently fighting over the currently Iron Island-held territory of the Ten Towers. So we're going to be kind of going back and forth between the North and the South to see who was able to pull through in the latest conflict. Now, if you ask me, as in who I really hope that will win this particular game, I'm going to go for the underdog. I'm going to go for Mance Rayder. I know a lot of you guys might not be you know, rooting for Mance Rayder right now, but I certainly am. He's definitely got very interesting units, including some wildling war mammoths, and he's even kind of colonized the, you know, past the wall a bit over here in Craster's Keep. So very interesting character, definitely very interesting civilization we'll keep our eye on as well. So again, we're going to go ahead and begin right where we left off, and do notice that in the last episode, the Vale, led by Peter Baelish, has just made peace with the, with Dragonstone, which is led by Stannis Baratheon, Stannis the Manus. So they're currently at peace, although Stannis was able to basically forced to give the City of Driftmark to Peter Baelish, who is himself increasing very, very steadily in power. So again, we're going to go and end the turn. And as many of you guys have jotted down in the comments below, you guys didn't really quite like it when the combat animations were on, so I've opted to turn off the combat animations in order to kind of speed things up a little bit. I know a few of you guys did like the combat animation, so if I, again, just leave in the comment box below whether or not you guys want to keep it or want to really get rid of it. I might actually make a poll for this particular video too, just kind of get a you know, representative sample of what you guys would like to see here in the future. And I do check the comments, by the way, so, you know, your opinion is definitely, you know, not worthless. I do check your opinions regularly. There are just some videos that I really don't check the comments on, like, you know, for example, the Europa Universalis video series I'm currently doing on King of the North. I'm about to shell it just because that video series has been going on for way too long. I think I started doing this in, like, October, and really it's, like, 15 patches behind the actual retail version of the game. So I'm going to shell that and make another Europa Universalis video series for those of you guys who do watch those series. But enough of that. We are talking about Civilization, and in fact, we're talking about Game of Thrones. And very interestingly enough, the Tullys of Riverrun are laying siege to Renly Baratheon's Haystack Hall, the very immediate south of King's Landing itself. So interesting development, no doubt. We're going to be keeping our eye on that. And in fact, another thing that we're going to be keeping our eye on is that the Storm's Inn, the capital, the very, very capital of Renly Baratheon itself, is under siege. We see that they have got, the Dornish forces have a veritable army surrounding Storm's Inn. Now, whether or not Renly is able to, keep these enemies at bay, we will see, but being under attack from two different fronts does not bode well for Renly Baratheon. Now, up here in the north, it seems like Robb Stark's attack on the Ten Towers has been repelled by a joint force of archers and some boatmen. Of course, the Iron Islands is famed for its boatmen. And going even further north, we notice that man behind the wall, the king behind the wall, Mance Raydor, has some settlers on top of some mammoths, so we're going to see where they go. I have no idea where they're heading, but we'll figure it out here in a minute. Going back down south, again, the Tyrells are not really doing too much. I haven't talked about them that much just because they're kind of boring. They are not at war right now. They've got another city up here in the north, which they've also colonized. So if Robb Stark isn't careful, most of this territory, most of his, birthright and domain is going to be colonized. So he better focus on making some colonists himself in addition to keeping out those damn Iron Islanders from his, domain. So again, going back down to the south here, let's go and take a look at what's going on with Renly. So, basically, Peter Baelish and the Reach are currently friends. The Reach, what is this exactly? I don't actually know. Again, I'm not exactly very good at Game of Thrones. I think the Reach is referring to the Tyrells. Yeah, it's referring to the Tyrells. So, I got that right, at least. Although, initially, I did not. So, Peter Baelish and the Tyrells are friends. That seems a bit scary, as they're both definitely more of the duplicitous and cunning of this series, in particular in Game of Thrones and in the Song of Ice and Fire trilogy. Not trilogy. Why the hell did I say trilogy? Series. I do these late at night when I'm tired. So, again, if I make any very blatant mistakes, feel free to, lampoon me in the comment section below. But keep in mind, I'm trying my very hardest here. Which, quite frankly, is not generally hard enough. So, anyways, Iron Islanders are still very, very secure in their positions in the north. In fact, they actually are sending out some tentative bowmen to kind of harass Robb Stark. While in the south, the siege against Renly Baratheon is not going too well on the part of the Riverrun Tyrells. Tullys, sorry, not Tyrells, the Tullys. The Tullys, unfortunately, were not able to actually send a warrior or a melee unit out to take Haystack Hall. So as a result, Renly is kind of just spitting in their general vicinity and destroying their range units, which are basically worthless. And in fact, not only that, but Renly was able to ward off the Dornish invasion from the south by virtue of the fact of their, their city's bombardment and due to the fact that the Civilization AI is incredibly stupid and sends their men into the sea off of the coast where they are easily destroyed by Renly Baratheon's superior garrison. Of note, the Tullys are just on a rampage. They've signed peace with Renly Baratheon himself and have taken Haystack Hall in the peace deal. Very, very interesting now that the Tullys control such a massive part of central and southern Westeros. It's definitely a very interesting development, of course, as they are by far the most aggressive. And quite frankly, I'm surprised because I didn't really necessarily view the Tullys as this aggressive force to be reckoned with, but sure enough, they are. So, interestingly enough, we actually see that the city-state of Harrenhal has declared war on the Lannisters, and the Tullys are still at war with the Lannisters, too. So, we might see the Crag falling in the hands of the Tullys as well, which is just incredibly interesting, again, as the Lannisters are just fallen from glory, They can't really pay off their enemies anymore, it would seem. And unlike the book and the series alike, the Lannisters are just reduced from this period, this position of glory into this position of just trying to hang on to their very life. Of course, they've set up another city, the Golden Tooth, to the immediate west of the capital, the Tully capital of Riverrun, which is just a bad idea. Let's be honest, just a terribly bad idea. We'll see how that pays off for them. Definitely not very positively, I'm sure. So here we go. We are waiting for the Lannisters to do their turn. And let's see what else is happening here. So again, the Dornish have pulled back from their position over here in the Stormlands. It seems like they're trying to consolidate their troops for maybe another invasion. But as of right now, they might have learned their lesson. They have a very, very poorly maintained army. In fact, even Renly might have a bigger army than them at this point. So let's go ahead and focus our conflict on the north between the Tullys and the Lannisters. And in fact, the Iron Islanders and the Northmen as well. So let's go to the north again to kind of see what Robb Stark is up to. Nothing much, it would seem. Other than building up his infrastructure, of course, just along the lines of everybody else as well. And Mance Raider has set up his next city, I believe his his sixth city in White Tree, which is immediately south of the wall. So kind of just pointing his finger at Castle Black and saying, come and get it, you bunch of, pretentious bastards. You can't stop our expansion to the south of the wall. And in fact, they actually have another settler once again to the east of the Fist of the First Men. So honestly, I'm a bit pleased. I'm glad to see that my favorite civilization is expanding incredibly fast. They're expanding faster than a bunch of rabbits on a deserted island. I mean, they're just keeping at it here. So that's great to see. Definitely an interesting development. And then Peter and Dorne have both progressed to the next era, the Age of Valyria. I'm not exactly, again, sure what these ages are broken down into, but I think they're at least somewhat congruent with the civilization eras in the base game. Now over here, the Crag is still fighting on for its survival here, and it's doing a pretty damn good job. Being in a position that only allows an invader to attack from one side, of course not taking into account a naval invasion, allows this Lannister city to kind of hold on and really take advantage of this geographical wall that they have between themselves and the rest of the world. Now, of course, what's interesting is that the Tyrells of the Reach are surrounding Castle Rock, but I do not think they're at war. In fact, just to double check, let's go ahead and see. Yes, they are not currently at war with Tywin Lannister, which is good. It's a good thing. I'm going to go ahead and say goodbye to the old Lady Olenna and head back into the campaign map. So unfortunately, for those of you guys who like Renly Baratheon, well, I got bad news. He's reduced to a two-state minor with a very small military. While those of you who are supporting the Tyrells are probably, or rather the Tullys, are probably in a pretty happy spot at this point in time, which is a good thing. In terms of what else is happening, we see that Stannis the Manus is sending a red settler, I guess, in representation of their religion, to the north. And speaking of religions, the old gods have basically spread across the entire map at a very, very fast and kind of relentless rate. There's only one other rival religion at this point in time, if I am not mistaken. Although we can certainly pull it up in the world religion overview. Right. So the Drowned God only claims one city, while the Stark Old God Faith claims 10. So really no competition there at the detriment to everybody else. So we see Stannis has set up another settler right outside of his city of Sharppoint in the northeast. What else is going on right now of particular note? Nothing too much. Let's just keep ending the turns. Worry not, this game will get interesting, of course. We do have periods of downtime, but this is Game of Thrones, so surely there will be some violence that will pick up here in a minute. And I definitely did not speak too soon, as the city, the Lannister city of the Golden Tooth, to the very north of Castle Rock itself, is under siege by the Tullys of Riverrun. So as of right now, this is the only interesting thing going on. Oh, but I misspoke. The Lannisters have signed peace with the Tullys. And Tywin has made peace with Harrenhal as well. Interesting. So now the Lannisters are at peace. We'll have to see what they do. They'll probably send out some settlers, more than likely. But to where, we have no idea. Well, at the same time, there are some naval battles off of the coast of the Stormlands and Dorne, where nothing too much is happening again. Looks like they're both a bit cautious with their naval units, which is interesting. So, big news. Peter Baelish, the duplicitous man himself, has decided to wage war from his kingdom towards the Tullys. So definitely two of the most strongly entrenched, sovereignties or kingdoms of Westeros are currently at war with each other. What's going to happen? Well, we're going to have to find out, because this is definitely going to leave a stain of conflict across the land. Let's go ahead and see. But right now, Peter Baelish is taking some pot shots at the capital city of Riverrun itself. If he is going to be able to do this in the future, remains to be seen whether or not the Tullys are able to kind of ward off of his invasion with their own troops. Of course, Peter's city of Heart's Home, that is to say the Vale city of Heart's Home, is actually in the middle of the Tully, kingdom and domain. So it remains to be seen whether or not this city is just absolutely taken over and put to the torch by the Tullys themselves. So that's going to be an interesting thing to see. But also of particular note is the fact that Mance Rayner has set up his next city, his seventh city, of Molestown to the southeast of Moletown. Well, I guess I misspelled this Moletown. Of course, I guess it was Molestown. But anyways, we got two Moletowns. We're going to have to see which one's the better one, I guess, in the future. I'm going to stay out of that discussion, though. Let's go back to the south and see again what's happening here. And of particular note also, Stannis the Manus, Stannis Baratheon, has set up his third city, or rather fourth city, if you don't include the Driftmark city that was taken by Peter, the city of Claw Isle, which is, again, not an island, but these naming conventions are never accurate anyway, so it doesn't matter. Let's go ahead and focus on the war between Peter Baelish and the Tullys of Riverrun. Let's go ahead and see what happens. So Elena of the Reach has also declared war on the Tullys. So this is going to be an interesting development. The Tullys, once the most powerful of central and kind of like southern central Westeros, are now on a two-front war between Peter Baelish and Olenna Tyrell. Both, of course, very duplicitous characters. So we're going to have to see what happens here. Of course, Elena has a very, very massive army heading directly towards Raven Tree Hall, which itself is very lightly and scarcely defended. This is going to be an interesting development. Let's see what happens. So again, Peter Baelish is kind of skirmishing with the Tyrells outside of their capital city. No territorial changes as of yet. While simultaneously, the Tyrells, led by Elena, are just destroying Raven Tree Hall. And interestingly enough, Renly has declared war on the Tyrells now, thus seeing this as an opportunity to take back his territory and his city of Haystack Hall, and the city of Lorath? What the hell is that? I think that's Old Town? Yeah, the city of Old Town has also declared war on the Tullys. Even the city-states are smelling the blood in the water. They want their own part of the pie. Interesting development. Again, let's go ahead and put our camera around here, just to watch the fall of the Tullys. Renly has made peace with the Dornish invaders of the south. It looks like this is a white peace, that is to say that no territory has changed, which will allow Renly kind of focus his attentions on Haystack Hall and perhaps even capturing a Riverrun settler for himself. Let's go ahead and end the turn and see what happens. Very, very interesting. The Reach, that is to say, Olenna Tyrell has currently taken the previously, I believe it was a Riverrun city, but I'm trying to remember who controlled Raven Tree Hall before Riverrun did. And I think it's actually it was a Tully territory to begin with. So interesting development that the Tullys are losing the territory to the Tyrells, and the future of both Haystack Hall and the capital Riverrun and even the city of Ashmark are in the air. We don't know what's going to happen. Peter's got some catapults that are being led into the city of Heart's Home, which could either go southeast and take Haystack Hall or to the northwest and take out Ashmark and Riverrun. Let's go and end the turn and find out. So the Tullys have made peace with Old Town. Again, I don't really know why Old Town has decided to wage war against them. Very, very strange. and a joint army, that is to say, maybe even three, or no, two host armies, both the Tyrells and the Baratheons, that is led by the Rindley, are trying to take Haystack Hall back. Let's go ahead and see what happens. Even Olenna is trying to help out Rindley in taking back the city, or she might actually snipe the city from Rindley in the variant. No, Rindley was able to take back Haystack Hall, thus reestablishing power for Rindley Baratheon of the Stormlands back to the immediate south of King's Landing. Haystack Hall has been reconquered and reclaimed. But this is not good news necessarily, because the newest Tyrell city of Seaguard is to the immediate southwest of the Rindley's capital of Storm's End. Not Stormwind, for those of you guys who play World of Warcraft, but Storm's End, which is a very similar name. And also very interesting is it seems that Tully, Edmure Tully only settles on rivers. And I'm not sure if this is like a bias or if this is just a coincidence, but even the new city of Seaguard is located on a river. Very interesting. I have no idea why. Perhaps we'll find out in the future. Let's go and end the turn and see what happens. So again, Peter Baelish is consolidating his forces in both Heart's Home and Goldtown to make a strike on the Tullys of Riverrun, while the Tully city of Seaguard is buying trebuchets and catapults. I was going to say tree bucket, but let's be honest, it's a really, like, you know, English way of pronouncing it. The word is trebuchet. And they are currently, making some siege weapons over here as we speak. Interesting developments. The Tullys are in a very desperate and dire situation, to the point that they have actually decided to occupy Ashmark instead of keeping it puppeted. They want direct control over the production of the city so that perhaps they can settle with some more defenses. Interestingly enough, Robb Stark, I believe, is still at war against... they're still at war with the Iron Islands. They've been at war for hundreds of years, in fact. Longer than, I guess, Robb Stark should be alive for. But, you know, again, these civilization leaders are mortal. Let's just pretend and not question the fact that these leaders are going to live for thousands of years while their, country burns. Anyways, let's go back to the south, to the heartland of conflicts. The Tyrells seem to be reconsolidating their forces before they strike Ashmark along with Peter Baelish of the Vale. Let's go and see what happens by ending the turn. And down here in the south, again, the city of Seaguard is still secure, although my guess is that Rindley Baratheon will probably be able to take over one of their siege instruments here in the future. But of course, being across the river in this kind of marshy and mountainous terrain, the Tullys might be able to wage guerrilla warfare on anybody who decides to take Seaguard for themselves. So my guess is that Peter Baelish and Olenna Tyrell might make peace with the Tullys, but if they don't, if they decide to push into the Tully domain, potentially they have the ability to wipe out Edmure outside of his, I guess, stronghold of Seaguard in the southeast of Westeros. In the north, looks like there might be a conflict between Castle Black and Mance Raydor. Let's go and see what happens. Because if they are at war, that means that the mammoths are going to be being hit by a... So Castle Black, the Night's Watch, is at war with Mance Raydor. What's new, really? I mean, this is very much something that's going to be happening over and over again. History does tend to repeat itself, even in fictional and fantasy environments. Right. Enough of that. Let's go ahead and end the turn. I'm not exactly sure what Olenna and, Peter Baelish are up to, but they're still not invading. I guess they're still trying to consolidate their forces. And Traitor Town. What the hell is Traitor Town? Is that Harrenhal? No, that's Karth. Again, I had to rename these. Yeah, so King's Landing itself has declared war on the Tullys. So even Joffrey Baratheon is pissed off with the Tullys. We're going to have to see how this changes things, if it changes anything, really, by ending the turn. Right, so the Tullys have just taken out one of the warriors that belonged to the Tullys. The Tyrells, I'm sorry, I misspoke. And the Tyrells are pushing into Ashmark along with Peter Baelish's offense in the north. It's a false flag, I believe. I think Peter Baelish is just trying to distract the Tullys into defending their capital so that his ally, Olenna of Tyrell, Olenna Tyrell of the Reach, can take over this previously Lannister-held territory, which has been ever since administered by the Tullys. By the way, for those of you guys who are rooting for a particular faction, in the comments below, go ahead and put who you think or who you want to win. I mean, of course, it's going to be different between who you think is going to win and who you want to win. So instead of just like looking at the score screen over here, which we have not actually gone over yet, of course, Rob is very much still in the lead. I want you guys to say who you want to win, like which house you're supporting, if there's, you know, a particular house that you are supporting more than the others. So Peter Baelish has made peace with the Tullys. Has anything changed in terms of territory? I don't think so. Nothing. So that leaves Tyrell, Olenna Tyrell, still in war against the Tullys. Now that her ally has backed out, she's making a very, very risky gambit here by trying to take the city of Ashmark. Of course, her forces are being brutalized by both attrition and the Tully defenders. Let's go and see how this plays out. Yet another religion was founded, this time by Highgarden, that is to say, Olenna. She has made the Faith of the Seven, which is, of course, the dominant faith in the A Song of Ice and Fire and Game of Thrones series. It'll be interesting when, you know, the old god faith is spreading across Westeros, and, you know, the Faith of the Seven is just the minority religion. It's very different than the, you know, what actually happened and this particular fantasy series. So this is an interesting development, of course, as well. What's also incredibly interesting is that not only were the Tullys able to push back the Tyrells, but it looks like the Tully army is setting up some more bannermen in which to potentially push back the Tyrells back into Highgarden. We'll have to see that plays out. And at the same time, the previously, at least what I thought to be, an impervious and invincible Tully stronghold of Seaguard is under attack by Renly Baratheon's forces of the Stormlands. We're going to have to see how that plays out here. So the Tullys are still very tenaciously pushing back the Baratheon forces from Seaguard. It looks like Renly Baratheon is going to have to stop his attack very, very soon. Right. And while we weren't even looking, and I do apologize, but Robb Stark has laid siege not only to Ten Towers, but has claimed the city for himself. Very interesting development as the Iron Islanders are pushed back yet again. We'll have to see if their city of Lordsport is able to maintain against Robb Stark's invasion, where Robb Stark is trying to unite the North, it would appear. And the city of Castle Black is still under siege. That is to say, the Night's Watch is still under siege by Mance Radar. Very, very interesting. Let's go back down to the south. And let's actually, now that we've seen that Robb Stark is able to, what he's capable of, let's go ahead and see if the King of the North is pushing down to the south. He is towards Lordsport, the city that belongs again to the Greyjoys, Lord Balon Greyjoy. I always forget his first name. Of course, Theon is a bit more memorable just due to the fact of the circumstances that take place in and around, you know, what ends up happening to him, what he becomes. I'm not going to get into the spoilers, reek. But the Westerlands has... Okay, now this is interesting. Because the city, or rather because the Faith of the Seven has already been developed, Stannis was not able to found the monotheistic fire god faith that he believes in, but the Lannisters have actually decided to make the faith of Rylar theirs. Now, the Lannisters in the series, again, do not worship this monotheistic fire god, but in this series they do, so we're going to have to see how it goes, considering they are surrounded by foreign faiths, both the Drowned God and... The old gods. So let's go back to the north, Lordsport again. More than likely going to fall to Robb Stark in the next episode. Not quite this episode, I'm afraid, as this episode is almost over. And the Tyrells at this point in time seem to be at some sort of impasse between the Tyrells. So the Tullys and the Tyrells currently are at an impasse. They're currently at some sort of truce, it would appear. While Renly Baratheon is completely unable to dislodge Seaguard from the Stormlands. So Olenna has made peace with the Tyrells. The Tullys, I'm sorry. The Tyrells have made peace with the Tullys. I can't say the Tyrells make peace with the Tyrells because that doesn't make any sense. But the Tyrells have made peace with the Tullys. which is probably a good thing for the Tullys. Tyrells will definitely have some time to rebuild, and in fact, the Tyrells actually currently have another settler that they will more than likely send out. I have not touched upon Dorne very much. This is because Dorne has not really expanded very much outside of their own domain, outside of Dorne. But what's interesting is that they are also building up yet another kind of mounted army, probably either to take Seaguard or the Stormlands. And I guess as a unintended positive side effect or consequence of the Tullys taking this territory to the southwest of Renly, the city of Seaguard might actually present a formidable obstacle to Dornish ambitions in the Stormlands. Dorne will have to go through Seaguard to take Storm's End or Bronzegate, unless they want to mount a naval expedition, which will more than likely mount in failure with the civilization's terrible naval AI. So again, thank you guys, as always, for watching this sixth episode of the Game of Thrones AI free-for-all. Stay tuned for the next one, where it looks like Robb Stark is poised to take out the very last remaining Iron Island possession in the north here, to the southwest of Ten Towers. And I really want to keep my eyes on Mance Rayedar, who will more than likely come into conflict with Robb Stark in the future. So again, guys, I hope you enjoyed. Before we end this episode, though, I'm going to give you guys a bit of a bonus here by going over the demographics. So for population, the Tullys are still in the lead, which is quite interesting. Actually, I didn't even notice this, but look at the... Okay, no, never mind. I thought it was in the north. I was like, why do the Tullys control a city in the north? They don't. I misspoke. But the Tullys have a massive population in Riverrun, a population of 17, which is really going to give them a lot more production and really cultural and both economic output over their rivals. So again, they have the lead in population. In terms of crop yield, it belongs to the Starks, although that seems a bit strange considering that they rule over largely a tundra and barren, cold and frigid wasteland in the north. But anyways, whatever. In terms of manufactured goods, soldiers and approval, Dorne is in the lead. And the Tyrells are winning with gold, not the Lannisters. The Tyrells are actually more wealthy than the Lannisters at this point. In terms of land, Mance Rayedar is in the lead, which makes me happy. And finally, in literacy, the Tyrells are also in the lead. They have a massive 32% of the population that can read, and of course, in this time period, that's actually quite a bit. So again, I hope you guys enjoyed this episode, and stay tuned for episode 7. It'll be out soon. Thanks again, guys, and take care.